So first let us discuss 2nd September shift 1 questions. The first question is, in Carrier's method of estimation of halogen, 0.172 gram of an organic compound showed the presence of 0.08 gram of bromine. Which of these is the correct structure of the compound? So that is a question. So they have given a method, Carrier's method of estimation of halogen. So this is a general information, but this reaction or this method is not necessary to solve this question. Actually, this is a simple mathematical question only. The information that they have given is 0.172 gram of an organic compound contains 0.08 gram of bromine. So this is a basic information that they have given. So what we need to find out is the percentage of bromine in this given compound. I mean, in this question, whatever they asked to know, so they need to find out the percentage of bromine in the compound. So for that, you need to use a formula. The formula is to identify the percentage of bromine is weight of bromine divided by overall weight of the compound into 100. So the given value is 0.08 gram of bromine. So this is bromine value, you can see, and this is the overall weight of the compound they have taken. So that is 0.172 gram of the compound that they have given, and if you multiply by 100 means you will get 46.5 percentage of bromine. So this is a percentage of bromine. So you can conclude that the given compound has 46.5 percentage of bromine. So now our duty is to find out which compound is having 46.5 percentage of bromine, and that will be the unknown compound. That is the answer. Okay, so for that purpose we will solve one by one. So first let us discuss option A. So in this compound, that is 4-bromoaniline, and the same formula only are going to use weight of bromine. This is atomic weight of bromine, that is 80. This is overall molecular weight. Molecular weight of this compound is 172. So this is approximate value only. So this is 172. 80 divided by 172 into 100, if you put 46.5 percentage of bromine. So you can see this is the answer. So what we have calculated from the question is 46.5 percentage of bromine, and this first option is exactly matching with this and that whatever that unknown compound value, and this is the answer. The question is over, but let us solve the other options also. For example, this is option B. So in this case, that weight of bromine is 80 and the overall weight of the compound is 109. So if you multiply by 100, it will give 73.4 percentage of bromine. So next, option C, that is you have two bromine atoms here. So you have to find out by 160 divided by 251. So into 100, if you put, means you will get 63.7 percentage of bromine. And you can see the option D, that is 80 divided by 95. So this is bromomethane. And if you multiply by 100, you will get 84.2 percentage of bromine. So you may think this question is little bit tough, but you can see this just exactly similar numbers they have given. You can see here. So if you multiply by 100 here, and here also if you multiply by 100, it will come, this is 80 divided by 172. So the exact value they have given in the option. So the question is easy. So if they are asking some numerical question, means you don't get confused. You try to solve the question with a simple possible way, means you will get the answer. Okay, so let us go to the next question. So this question is like fill in the blanks question. The number of chiral carbons present in the molecule given below is. So you need to find out how many chiral centers are present in this compound. Say for example, this carbon is chiral, and this carbon, you have hydrogen atom here. So this is also chiral, and here also one hydrogen atom is present, and this is also a chiral carbon. And you can check here one hydrogen is present, so this is also chiral because four different groups are connected here. And finally here also you can see one hydrogen is present, and this side ethyl, this side CH2 nitrogen, here you have CH, that is bridged carbon. So this is also a chiral center. So if you count the overall chiral centers that you will get, there are 5 chiral centers which are present in this compound, and the answer is 5. Simple question. Okay, so now let us discuss 2nd September shift 2 questions. So the first question is, the major product of the following reaction is. So you are given a tri-substituted benzene system, and you are treating with the concentrated nitric acid and concentrated sulfuric acid. So the reaction is nitration. So now, which is going to be the answer? That is a question. So in this type of electrophilic aromatic substitution, means you can solve the question two possible ways. Either, well, the first way is based on the electron donating group and based on the ortho effect also. Okay, so what is an electron donating group? Means this is the strongest electronic group, electron donating group, because this oxygen is having lone pair of electron. So if it gives electron, means the electron density will be maximum at ortho and para position. Okay, so you can call it as ortho para director, because I have already made a couple of videos based on this ortho meta para directors and all. So you can watch that video if you have time. So this nitration can be taking place at this position or at this position. But if you check with this this ortho position, means you have a 4 substituted system. Say for example, if this is a reacting position, means you may expect the formation of option B. But this continuous 4 substitution benzene, means it is difficult to form. So this cannot be the answer. And the next what possible answer is, this is the one, that is option C. This is a correct answer, and this is electron withdrawing group. When you have electron withdrawing group, there will be operation of ortho effect will be taking place. So because of that also, there is a reactivity at para position to this hydroxy group. So the right answer is option C. So now let us discuss the next question. So if you spill a chemical toilet cleaning liquid on your hand, your first aid would be. So that's toilet cleaning liquid will be, generally this is strong acid. So if it spill on your hand, it will cause irritation. So if you want to neutralize that strong acid, means you need to use base. So which of the following is the best choice that we need to check? So option A, they have given aqueous ammonia, so that is also base. And option C is vinegar. Vinegar means like it is acidic acid type only, so it is acid, so it cannot be the possible. And option C is aqueous sodium bicarbonate, and fourth one is aqueous sodium hydroxide. So this A and this D, that is aqueous ammonia and aqueous sodium hydroxide, are strong base. So strong base also will cause irritation on your skin. So you can, if you have done some experiment in your laboratory, if sodium hydroxide is fall on your skin, means it will cause some kind of irritation. So you should not use this strong base also. And this aqueous ammonia also is not a good choice. So the right answer is aqueous sodium bicarbonate. It is a mild base. So you need to dissolve that sodium hydroxide and in water, and you can apply the solution. So that is the best way of neutralizing this acid. This strong acid you need to neutralize with excess of sodium bicarbonate solution. So this is a correct answer, that is option C. Fine. So now let us discuss 3rd September shift 1 questions. The first question is, which of the following compounds produces an optically inactive compound on hydrogenation? So we know that when you treat an alkene with hydrogenation condition, that is hydrogen in the presence of a metal, so what will happen? This double bond will be converted into single bond, that is pi bond will be broken and hydrogen will be added. So this step is said to be hydrogenation. Fine. So now let us treat all the alkene under the condition of hydrogenation, and we need to find out which product is optically inactive. Say for example, when you treat this compound under hydrogenation condition, so here you have hydrogen at front side, methyl group, and this double bond will be converted into single bond. Here you have this two methyl groups. So now let us discuss the second option. the third answer is and the fourth option is this one. So now let us check the chirality, that is optical active nature of the all the four products. Okay, so here you have four different groups, because so this one, 1, 2, 3, and 4, this is optically active. If you check here, you have two different groups, but here you have two same groups, that is isopropyl groups, both are at same in terms of number of carbon. So it is optically inactive, same groups are present, it is optically inactive, and that is the answer. And if you check with the other options, so this is optically active because of four different groups. Here you have ethyl actually, and here also you have one side you have 1, 2, 3, this is a propyl group, other side you have isopropyl group, and here you have hydrogen and methyl, and this is also optically active compound. So the right answer is option B. So that will be giving optically inactive product. Fine. So now let us discuss the next question. So the question is, an organic compound A having a molecular formula C10H20O2 was hydrolyzed with dilute sulfuric acid to give a carboxylic acid B and an alcohol C. Okay, so A is a compound, you are doing hydrolyzing with aqueous sulfuric acid, and you are getting carboxylic acid and alcohol. So when you do hydrolysis, you are getting carboxylic acid and alcohol, means what you have is an ester. So when you have an ester, if you do hydrolysis, you will get this bond will be broken, here OH will be added, and this end you have hydrogen will be added, and one end you have carboxylic acid, other end you have alcohol. Okay, so oxidation of C, so that means this alcohol, I'm doing oxidation of C with CrO3H2SO, that means Jones reagent condition, I'm doing oxidation, the compound C produced B. So that means if I oxidize the alcohol C, I will get back this compound B. Okay, which of the following structures are not possible for A? So that is a thing they are asked. Okay, so which is not giving the compound B when it is going for oxidation. Okay, so you are given four options. Say for example, this compound is ester, so this compound you need to redraw in this way, that is CH3 C, single bond C, double bond O. Here you have CH2 C, CH3 thrice. Fine. So if I do hydrolysis, so this will be added hydrogen, and this will be added OH. I'm not giving a complete mechanism. This is a shortcut way that you need to understand. Okay. So I'm just erasing for our convenient. So you will get here CH3 three times carbon, and here you have C double bond O OH, and this side you have hydrogen, oxygen, CH2 C CH3 thrice. So now I am doing oxidation. So what will happen when you use oxidation, that is Jones reagent, means this primary alcohol will be converted into aldehyde initially, that is CHO carbon CH3 three times. So this is a strong oxidizing agent. This chromium trioxide with sulfuric acid is strong oxidizing agent. Strong oxidizing agent will oxidize this aldehyde into carboxylic acid. So when you treat under the condition of oxidation, this will be converted to carboxylic acid. So you can see these two compounds are same. So that means when you oxidize this primary alcohol, you will end up with the formation of this carboxylic acid. That is, say for example, this is B and this is C, means if I oxidize C, I'm getting back B. So this is a correct answer. Okay. So this is not the question that they have asked actually. Okay. The second thing is, so I can draw here itself. Here I am adding hydrogen, here I am adding OH, so I will get on hydrolysis CH3, CH2, CH2, COOH, plus here I have hydrogen, oxygen, CH2, 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 CH3. Okay, so if I do oxidation means, so this is a primary alcohol. So primary alcohol, if I do oxidation, you will get aldehyde. That means CH2, CH2, CH3. So now if you do over oxidation, so this aldehyde will be converted into corresponding carboxylic acid. You can check here. So this part will be converted into COOH, and that will be the same. So this compound is also giving carboxylic acid, and this is also the correct one. So let us discuss this compound. So you can see here, these first two compounds are ester functional groups. But this is not an ester functional group. You can see here, this, you can consider this as an R, and this also as R, and in between you have OCO, that means R O C double bond O R O R. I'm sorry. So this is not an ester functional group. This is simply a carbonate functional group. You can say this is carbonate. And you can do hydrolysis, but even if you do hydrolysis also, this is said to be an unstable compound, and you are not going to get that acid and alcohol product. Okay, so if you do hydrolysis means, say for example here hydrogen is adding and here OH is adding, means so you are not going to get the carboxylic acid here, because this is unstable system. So here itself the CO2 will be removed, so you won't be able to get this carboxylic acid. So this compound will not give the corresponding product what they have asked actually. So let us discuss the last one. So here I am doing hydrolysis. Here also you have ester functional group. So here hydrogen, here OH will be added, and you will get CH3, CH2, CH, CH3, COOH. And here you have hydrogen, oxygen, CH2, CH, CH3, CH2, CH3. And I am doing oxidation here by using Jones reagent. So this primary alcohol will be converted into aldehyde. And if I do over oxidation, so this aldehyde will be converted into carboxylic acid. You can check, these two compounds are same. That means if I oxidize this compound C, I will get back this carboxylic acid B. So first, that is A, B and 3, I mean D. So all the three compounds will give the corresponding carboxylic acid B when this alcohol is oxidized under the condition of Jones reagent. But this compound C will not give the corresponding answer, I mean the corresponding product will not form. So this is the correct option that they have asked. Okay, so the right answer is option C. Okay, fine. So now let us discuss the next method, next question, that is when Jeldahl method of nitrogen estimation fails for which of the following reaction products. So okay, so what do you mean by Jeldahl method? Jeldahl method is used to find out the presence of nitrogen atom in a given molecule. Okay, so this is a general information, but which compounds will not undergo Jeldahl method, that is also important. So when this nitrogen is present in a ring system, say for example pyridine, or if the nitrogen is present as nitro group, or if you have an azo compound, it is N triple bond N. So this is a simple, when nitrogen is present on the ring, or if you have a nitro group, if you have an azo system, means this Jeldahl method will not be useful to find out this nitrogen atoms. Okay, so other nitrogen atoms only it will be able to identify. So that basic information you need to know. So when you treat a nitro benzene with a tin and HCl as a reagent, means this nitro group will be converted into amine. So you have an amine, so this compound can be estimated by using Jeldahl methods. Okay, so next thing is when you have a benzonitrile, the compound name is benzonitrile, it is treated with lithium aluminium hydride. So when you treat a cyano group under lithium aluminium hydride condition, this will be converted into primary amine, that is CH2NS2. So here you will get a compound known as benzylamine. The name is benzylamine. So here also the nitrogen can be estimated by using Jelldal method. Yes, it is possible. So now let us discuss this compound. So this reaction is said to be Stefan's reduction. So I am giving a brief introduction about this Stefan's reduction. That means when you have a cyano compound and you are using under the condition of Stefan reducing condition, so what will happen? Here one hydrogen will be added, here one hydrogen will be added, and you will get RCH double bond NH. So this is said to be an imine. And if you do hydrolysis, second step they are using hydrolysis, you can see here. So if you do hydrolysis, here you will get hydrogen and here you will get oxygen. So here you will get that cyano will be converted into aldehyde. So this compound does not have nitrogen at all. So you cannot find the presence of nitrogen by using Jelldal method, because nitrogen itself not there. So there is no point in doing this method, because this will be converted into aldehyde and ammonia. Okay. So in this case, the same concept you can apply, that is CH2 first step, that is the first step I am doing, that is CH2 double bond NH. Here you have hydrogen. So if you do hydrolysis, this end will be converted to the corresponding aldehyde. So this nitrogen is left during the course of the reaction. So you cannot find out the presence of nitrogen in this compound. So this compound, the Jelldal method, is not possible. Okay. So next question is, when aniline is treated with sodium nitrite and HCl, that means this reaction is diazotization. We have already made one video or preparing this diazonium salt. So directly this aniline will be converted into benzene diazonium chloride salt, that is N2 with Cl minus. So this is said to be azo compound. You can draw in this way also. So I already said this Jelldal method is not useful to identify this ring nitrogen containing compound and nitro and azo compounds. So this is said to be an azo compound. So this compound also cannot be identified by using Jelldal method. So they have asked is the question, that is, the Jelldal method of nitrogen estimation fails for which of the following reaction products? So yes, this is failed and this one also is failed. That means 3 and 4 are failure. So that is, the right answer is option B. I hope that you are able to understand this question. So now let us discuss the next question, that is, the mechanism of SN1 reaction is given as. So they have given on SN1 reaction, that is Rx is undergoing reaction. Now it is separated, that is X is shifting here, this electron is shifting towards X, so it will be forming X minus, and this R is giving this electron to X, so it is having positive charge, it is said to be ion pair. So now this ion pair is reacting with the solvent that they are using, that is, it is converted into solvent separated ion pair. So now the solvent molecules will be surrounded this cation and anion. So that means it is said to be solvent separated ion pair. Now the next step is Y minus will be approaching this that is carbocation will form the corresponding product, that is R single bond Y, and this X will be leaving as X minus. So this is a general reaction they have given. A student writes general characteristics based on the given mechanism as. Okay, so they have given four statement. So which is the correct one that we are asking? The first statement is, the reaction is favored by weak nucleophiles. So weak, what do you mean by weak nucleophile? Say for example, when you have water, alcohol, so this type of compounds are said to be weak nucleophiles. Because oxygen is not that very good donor, because it is one of the second most electronegative atoms in the periodic table. So it will not give its electron that easily. So it is a neutral compound. So other than that, the oxygen is having more electronegativity. So you can call it as weak nucleophile. Yes, it is correct. So the reaction is favored by a weak nucleophile is correct. So second thing is, that is R plus, that is carbocation. This is actually they are mentioning this one. R plus would be easily formed if the substituents are bulky. Okay, so let us discuss a little bit later. This is question mark you will put. So third thing is the reaction is accompanied by racemization. Yes, so we know that SN1 reaction means leading to the formation of racemic mixture. Yes, it is correct. Next one is the reaction is favored by non-polar solvent. I think I said this is as a nucleophile as well as solvent. So this weak nucleophile, they will act as a nucleophile as well as solvent. So water is a polar solvent because it will be separating as del plus and del minus. So it is said to be a polar solvent. So SN1 reaction is favored by polar solvent only. Okay, so they have given this statement that this is wrong. Okay, so now let us discuss the second statement that they have given, that carbocation would be easily formed if the substituents are bulky. It is not necessary. Say for example, when you have this type of compound, this compound having bulky substituents, but it will not undergo the migration of methyl group because you have one carbon in between. So this is said to be a bulky compound only, substituents only, but still the carbocation is primary. We know that in SN1 reaction tertiary carbocation will be more stable, so that will be the most reactive, followed by secondary and then primary. So primary is least reactive. So this is a primary center and you have a bulky group here, but it is far away from this this carbocation, so it does not connect with the bulkiness of the substituents. So this statement is wrong. So you need to say that if tertiary only will be undergoing reaction faster, tertiary carbocation will, is that means the reaction will be undergoing at faster rate. That is a correct way of understanding the concept. Bulkiness is nothing to do with the stability of this carbocation. So this statement 2 and 4 are wrong, and statement 1 and 3 that are correct. So the right answer is option B. Okay, so we'll discuss the next question. So this question is, which one of the following compounds possesses the most acidic hydrogen? So there is a rule. When electron withdrawing group increases, acidity of the hydrogen which is connected to the withdrawing group carbon containing carbon increases. That means you can, in short, you can say that when electron withdrawing group increases, the acidity of hydrogen will be increasing. That is the only thing that you need to know. Say for example, in this case, this is said to be melanonitrile, this compound name is. So in this case, this carbon is connected to two electron withdrawing group. This is propyne. So in propyne, you have you do not have any withdrawing group, but this carbon is sp hybridized and it is having 50% S character, but this is not that strong electron withdrawing when compared to this or cyano or carboxylic acid or ester, whatever may be. So it is not that electron withdrawing atom. Okay, so this will be not that acidic. So here you have a CH3 which is connected to C double bond O. So I said already carbonyl is electron withdrawing group, but here you have only one electron withdrawing group. So next, here you have this carbon is connected to three ester functional group. So here you have three electron withdrawing group. Ester groups are considered to be electron withdrawing groups. So when you have three electron withdrawing group means this will be the most acidic. If you apply this rule, when you have electron withdrawing group increasing in order means the acidity will be increasing. Here you have three electron withdrawing group and this is the correct answer. So this will be the most acidic, if you ask me, means this will be the most acidic, D. After that you can say A because it have two electron withdrawing group. So next you have C and the least acidic will be B. So this is a correct answer, but they are not asking the acidity order. They are asking only the most acidic hydrogen, that is option D. So simple question this is. Okay, so we'll go to the next question. Glycerol is separated in soap industries by, so okay, so we know that that saponification reaction, when you treat the fat with sodium hydroxide or potassium hydroxide, will form the corresponding product as soap, and along with that you will get glycerol. So that is from glycerol, you need to from the mixture you need to remove glycerol, and that is a separation method. Which method is suitable for the separation of this glycerol? The first thing is steam distillation, second thing is differential extraction, third thing is distillation under reduced pressure, and fourth one is fractional distillation. Okay, so now let us discuss the reaction that I have already said. This is fat. This is fat, and you treat with sodium hydroxide, you will get glycerol and corresponding soap. So this is a mixture. So from this mixture, I need to separate this glycerol, then only I can collect this soap. Fine. So which is a suitable method? That is a question. So you can see this boiling point of glycerol, that is 290 degrees centigrade. Suppose if I do distillation, means, so this is a container, here you have soap and glycerol. Say for example, this is RB flask, and here it is connected with a condenser, and after that condenser here you have a receiver. So if I heat here, so this glycerol will be evaporated and it will be condensed by cooling of water, finally you will get here. So this is a basic process, because all are under distillation process only. So which is a suitable distillation? So you can see the boiling point is 290 degree. Suppose if it is 290 degree, means I need to give beyond 290 degree, I need to heat here around 330 degree or 350 degree only, I need to heat, then only it will try to evaporate from the mixture. But if I heat at 330 degree, means it is so high temperature, so this will cause decomposition of product. So decomposition means, that means it will be decomposed. Decomposed means this product will be converted into some other kind of product. So that is unwanted for us. So we should not go for higher temperature. So we need to reduce the temperature so that this will not undergo decomposed. Okay. So when it does not undergo decomposed, means you can easily separate glycerol from this soap. So that is our basic idea. So how can you reduce the temperature? When you reduce the pressure, the boiling point of this compound will be reduced. Okay, so when you apply vacuum here, so when you connect with the vacuum pump and you apply vacuum, that means the pressure will be taken here, that means you are reducing the pressure inside the system. So when you as a result, this boiling point of this glycerol will be reduced. So instead of going 330 degree, you can go for at least 150 degree centigrade. And if you heat 150 degree along with applying vacuum, that means reducing the pressure, and here this glycerol will be evaporated and it will be condensed here. And through this process, you can avoid the decomposition of glycerol or soap. Okay, so this is said to be distillation under reduced pressure. Okay, so the right answer is option C, and this is an important method, and most of the industries, they are using this process. Okay, the distillation under reduced pressure, that means you are applying vacuum and thereby you are reducing the pressure inside the system. Fine. So now let us discuss the next question. So the next question is, the anti-fertility drug, that is Novastrol, can react with. So what do you mean by Novastrol? So I am giving the structure of Novastrol here. So this is a very big molecule, and this molecule, it has a few functional groups, and this compound will be reacting with which type of reagents? That is a question. So you can see this is first reagent, second reagent, third reagent. So that is a question. You can see the functional group that are given here. You have a phenol. You can draw like this. You have a phenol. You have a triple bond C, triple bond C. You have a hydroxy group. So which functional group, which functional group will be reacting with this reagents? That is a question. Say for example, let us discuss option A. And in option A, they are using bromine water. We know that when that unsaturation is present, that means when you have a double bond or triple bond, means if you do bromine water, means so bromination will be taking place. As a result, the indication will be bromine decolorization. So it will be reacting with bromine water. Yes, it is possible. The first one is correct. Second thing is, when you have zinc HCl, so zinc HCl means, zinc chloride HCl means, this reaction you can call it as Lucas test. So Lucas test is to identify the presence of alcohol functional group. So this Lucas test, Lucas reagent will be reacting with tertiary alcohol at faster rate. In this compound, you can see here, you have a tertiary alcohol, that means this carbon is connected to 1, 2, 3 carbon atom. So this is said to be a tertiary alcohol. When you treat this compound with a Lucas reagent, so this will be undergoing reaction and immediately, and you will get turbidity immediately. Fine. So now this also is correct. So let us discuss the third one, that is ferric chloride. So we have studied that when you treat a phenol with neutral ferric chloride, means it will form complex and it will give color. Say for example, if it is simple phenol, means when it is reacting with ferric chloride, you will get a purple color solution. And here you can check this compound is having a phenolic function group and it will be reacting with ferric chloride and it will give the corresponding color. So all phenol, it does not necessary to give same purple color. It depends on the phenolic group condition, the color will be changing. So this also will be reacting with ferric chloride, and this is the right answer, that is option A. So this compound will be reacting with all the three reagents, and that is the correct one. And if you check with the other three, so this won't be reacting in all the cases. So I'm skipping all the three cases here because that is not necessary for us. Fine. Now let us discuss the next question. The question is, the total number of monohalogenated organic products including stereoisomers in the following reaction are. So this is a fill in the blank question, and this is a question they have asked. Yeah, A, compound A, that is simplest optically active alkene, and you are treating with hydrogen nickel heat, that means hydrogenation here, followed by X2 heat, that means X means halogen here. And you can say this is halogenation reaction. So what can be the answer? First, let us take what is the simplest optically active alkene. So this is the simplest optically active alkene that we have. Okay, so you can say this is 3 methyl pentene. That is the simplest optically active alkene that we have. Okay, so that we need to identify. So I have already given here. So now this simplest optically active alkene, I am treating under the condition of hydrogen. So this double bond will be converted into single bond. Okay, so now this compound I have to treat with halogen. So what is the possible products that will be forming? That is a question they have asked. So you need to find out the possible hydrogens, how many different hydrogens that are present in this compound. Say for example, in this compound, these two groups are same, here also ethyl, here also ethyl. So you do not have to give labeling to these two carbons, because once you label here, means that is enough, both are same hydrogens only. So you can start with A, B and C, here D. So you have four set of hydrogen. So you can expect four different products, but that is not the case. They have asked a question including stereoisomers. So you need to solve each and every compound here. The first thing is, I'm replacing this hydrogen by an X group. So I will get this one. And this compound is chiral. You can say here, this carbon is having four different groups. Hydrogen, CH2, CH2H. And here you have CH2, CH3. Here also you have CH3. So this is chiral compound. So in this chiral means, you have two possibilities. That means one will be R, another one will be S. So RS will be enantiomers. So here you have an enantiomeric pair. Now I'm replacing this hydrogen, I'm putting one X group here. So now if you see this compound here, you have two chiral centers. When you have two chiral center, means how many possible isomers that we have, that is a question. So I have already said one formula, that is when you have two chiral center, means the total number of isomers that we want to find is, you have to use your formula 2 power n. So here you have two chiral centers, that means 2 power 2, you will get 4 isomers. So here you have enantiomer, means 2 isomers, that is stereoisomers. Here you have 4 stereoisomers. Here if you check here, that is compound C, that is hydrogen C, if I am replacing, I am putting X, means, and here you have this compound, and this compound is optically inactive because you have two same functional group. This is only one product. Okay, so next thing is here, that is the CH3 hydrogen, one of the hydrogens I am replacing by this X group, and this compound is also optically active because of same group, and here you have only one product. So if you combine all the products, you will get here 2, here 4, totally 6, 7 and 8. You will get totally 8 isomers as a product. So much important question. So you may ask this question here, what are the 4 isomers? So I'm drawing here this way, that is here you have CH3, here you have CH2CH3, that I am putting simply ET, that is ethyl group. So 2 hydrogen can be at left side, here you have XCH3. And I'm just replacing these two groups. So here you have X hydrogen, CH3 ethyl, and here you have CH3 hydrogen. So next thing is, I'm replacing these two groups. So CH3, here you have CH3 hydrogen, here you have hydrogen, X ethyl group. Finally, I'm replacing these two, I'm interchanging these two groups. Okay. So here you have X, CH3, hydrogen, hydrogen, CH3, ethyl groups. So these are the 4 stereoisomer that you will get. Okay. So you should not consider this one. So you need to, once you have chiral center, means you need to divide into 2, and the 2 only you need to take. Don't take this as a 3 compound. Okay. So this is the only one compound that is having 2 possible isomers, means you need to take only 2 only. Here you need to take only 4. Don't take this also, because this compound only is divided into 4 different types. So you need to take this as a 4 only. So don't take as 5. Okay. That is a mistake some people they will do. So keep in mind. Fine. So the right answer is 8 is the correct one. So now let us discuss that is 3rd September shift 2 questions. The question is 3 isomers A, B and C, molecular formula C8H11N, give the following results. So compound A, B, C, so having the molecular formula C8H11N, so they are giving the following results. The first one is A, compound A and compound C undergoing diazotization. Diazotization means you need to use sodium nitrite, HCl, and if you use this two compounds, means you will get two different compounds, that is P and Q. So compound A and C are converted into P and Q. So now this P and Q is hydrolyzed, followed by using oxidation with potassium permanganate and acid. So that means acidified potassium permanganate, you are getting the compound R and S. So PQ are converted into RS, where R is the product of A. Okay. So S is product of C. So that is a thing. So now they are given second information, that is R has low boiling point than S. So R and S are isomers in which R has low boiling point than S. Okay. So now let us discuss the third thing that we have. And here you have this compound B is treated with that is phenyl sulfonyl chloride. So when you treat this with this thing, means this is alkali insoluble product. So that is a thing, that the clue they have given. So this is a test for amine. So this is a very important question. This is a test for amine. So in this test, and let me explain this test first, that is when you have a primary amine and if you treat with this compound, that is you can say this is sulfonyl chloride, and you can also use para-toluene sulfonyl chloride also. and here this will be added and this will be leaving, and one hydrogen here, one Cl will be here leaving as HCl, and here you have R NH yes double bond O double bond O phenyl. So when you treat with a base, that is alkali means sodium hydroxide if I am doing, and this is a base that will be removing this hydrogen, this is acidic hydrogen, so it will be forming N minus here yes double bond O O phenyl, and the counter cation will be sodium. Now here you have anion and cation, so this is a salt. Okay, so when you have salt means it is soluble in water. So when you treat a primary amine means under this condition you will get water soluble product, whereas if you treat a secondary amine, say for example here you have a RNHR and you use the same condition phenyl sulfonyl chloride, when it is attacking here this will be leaving, and here you have hydrogen and here Cl will be removed as HCl, and I am removing this hydrogen and I am just keeping this R group here. Here you have S double bond O O phenyl. Fine. Now the thing is, if I use sodium hydroxide here, so here this compound does not have any acidic hydrogen, so this will not give water soluble product. So that means they have given the information, that is the compound B is a secondary amine, and then only it will be giving alkali insoluble product. That means alkali means base insoluble product. You can find that this is a secondary amine, that we can conclude. So the question is A, B, C are respectively. So they have given the option in this way. First, our duty is to find the compound B. We have already found out that compound B is a secondary amine. So this is A, this is B, and this is C. And this is a primary amine, this is secondary amine, secondary amine, secondary amine. So the first option is wrong, and it can be B, C, and D. From that option, you can see here, and here you can see this is a ethyl substituted aniline, and here also you can see here this is fourth position, this is substituted. So let us solve this example first, from that we will identify the corresponding answer. Fine, let us take this compound, that is this ortho ethyl aniline, and you are doing diacetylation here. So you will get a compound in this way. Say for example this is A means, and here you are getting compound P, and this compound P is treated under the condition of hydrolysis. That means hydrolysis, if you do hydrolysis means, so this diazo will be converted into phenol. Now I am treating this compound with a condition oxidation. That means when you treat this compound under the condition of oxidation, that means you need to know the basic reaction, that is when you treat toluene with KMnO4, that is acidified KMnO4, means you will get benzoic acid as a product. So that basic reaction that you need to know. And here also you can see here you have a benzylic hydrogen, so this will be converted into COOH. So here you have a salicylic acid, that is a product. So let us take this compound C. That is a compound C here, that is NS2 CH2 CH3. HCl, and here this will be converted into diazonium salt. And if you treat with hydrolysis condition, so this will be converted into OH. And if you do with potassium permanganate oxidation under acidic medium, so this will be converted into carboxylic acid. So you can conclude this here. If you treat compound A under the condition, you will get the product R, that is ortho having ortho mean salicylic acid. Whereas if you treat the compound C under this condition, you will get the compound that is S. Okay, so this is said to be ortho and para isomers. So you know that the basic thing, that is this ortho hydroxy benzoic acid, will be having hydrogen bonding here. So this hydrogen bonding is said to be intramolecular hydrogen bonding. Whereas the para compound, there will be hydrogen bonding which is said to be intermolecular hydrogen bonding. Okay, so when you have intramolecular hydrogen bonding, the boiling point of the compound will be low. Okay, so when you have an intermolecular hydrogen bonding, means the boiling point will be high because of plenty of molecules will be there. It will be like a polymeric system. So this compound will be having a boiling point high, and this will be having the boiling point low. And if you check with the clue that they have given, R, the compound R will be having low boiling point, then yes. So from this we can conclude that the compound, that is option B, is a correct answer. Okay.